One and all, welcome for a very special and epic, a mythical edition of Nick's Nonfiction here with your host, comic Nick Muniz. We've got the return of the Angel of Algeria, Mr. Albert Camus, with one of my top three books of all time, The Myth of Sisyphus. We go chronological order on the show. Make sure to go back and listen to The Stranger so you got your base of knowledge, because this book put absurdisms on the map. What kind of tea does Albert Camus drink? Absurdity. Camus was a playboy, 1940s Hollywood. He was chiefing big cigars with Dean Martin. Some say this guy was really studying existentialism. What is absurdisms, you might be asking yourself? It is that comical moment in life when an obese person tries to give you diet advice. Your poor friend is trying to give you a lecture on savings. It's a little absurd that you could die in Fallujah before you could buy a beer. Together, alone, new, normal, we're drowning in absurdities and upside-down world. Technically speaking, philosophically, absurdisms are merely defined as a way of thinking which those in despair can find peace. Sometimes the only way to logically make sense of the world is to laugh at it. It's taking two polarities and asking how these contradictions are not talked about, and this Myth of Sisyphus asks the biggest question in philosophy you can. Is life worth living? Camus says there is yet to be one man that has evaded death in the history of the species, so what we should do to entertain death is colorfully paint on the canvas of life. He's got all these poetic little one-liners. The flames of hell are worth the celestial perfumes of sin. It's one of the top three books I'm going to be putting out there. This inspires the way I put together shows, the way I think, the premises I come up with. He told all the other sophists at the time to move over, suckling on the teat of success. This is the book that took his body of work to the next level, put him on the map. It's the least fictitious myth that you will ever hear. Pretty ballsy out there. He calls one of the chapters philosophical suicide. To just be saying in the public square, guys are dying on the beaches of Normandy, should I take my own life? Is life worth living? That's a myth I'd like to see Adam Savage bust. Hey, Jamie, jump off this warehouse with a noose around your neck. Ladies and gentlemen, 22 veterans a day kill themselves in this country. Good thing they didn't get into beer at 18. They were getting into war. Camus is saying, this is the only question that philosophers should be focusing on. You guys could be saving lives up in the ivory tower. He's quoted saying, don't walk behind me, I may not lead. Don't walk in front of me, I ain't gonna follow. Just walk beside me, and we may be friends. Direct quote. We did nihilism Nietzsche, who says that life does not have meaning. Camus is telling you to give your life meaning. It's a cosmic joke. We're the only animals out here that know that we're gonna die. It's gonna fuck with your head, so you gotta laugh about it. What is Sisyphus's favorite beer? Rolling Rock. We will dip our toes into the nihilism, the Dostoyevskian existentialism, antinatalism maybe. It's gonna be a real fun show today. Excited to be sharing it. It's a birthday episode, so it's a bit self-indulgent. We'll probably go long. About the author, Albert Camus. We've done it before. As I said, we're doing the books in order in his career. This one, he threw out the characters. In The Stranger, we had Sad Merceau, an aloof philosopher, Albert. The book's about not knowing that his mother died. He just throws out all the character analysis for this book and gives us his thoughts straight up. It's not that Henry David Thoreau, the iceberg law of literature, you have to hide 90% of the meaning underneath the No, just tell us what you're trying to tell us, Albert. He's great for that. One of my favorite authors. Chapter 5 and 10 go over Dostoevsky too. So he's picking up Shakespeare's ball, passing it along, some really fun ideas. Camus said that there was an absurd widespread sensitivity at the time of writing this. He's putting the zeitgeist's thought into words. He's got his thumb on the pulse. I got a double copy I ordered this one on Amazon. They sent me two. The warehouse worker saw it was coming to my account. They're like, this is about stopping. Give them two books. I donated one to the book barn in Denver. This book could be saving lives. So we're going to be talking very lightly about the harshest of topics today. But it is all for a stoic, a self-empowering assertion at the end. Chapter one. Actually, let's throw it over to a word from our sponsors real quick. You better be following on Instagram at HarryShit. Subscribe, like. And welcome back. I'm sipping some coffee before chapter one, An Absurd Reasoning. We'll start her out with a quote, an 11-chapter epic. There is but one true serious philosophical problem, and that is suicide. Judging whether life is or is not worth living amounts to answering the fundamental question of philosophy. All the rest, whether the world has three dimensions, whether the mind has 8 or 12 categories, comes after. Much like Nietzsche does, Camus lobs grenades at his fellow philosophers, and he's calling them the fakes, the sophists, dating all the way back to Plato's time. There have been people that are peddling dogma instead of searching for truth. Someone's got to sit down Mr. Sigmund Freud for a stern talking. Entrapped memories. You seem to have a Pavlovian tic triggered by early childhood trauma. Well, Doc, me and a third of Americans this year lost our jobs. Should we jump off the top of the parking deck? The numbers are at an all-time high. I'm talking about the veterans as well. This is a very timely read. What are all these other philosophers? Oh, the train on the trolley tracks. The Phil 101. We got the biggest anomaly in biological organisms. Your only prerogative is to survive, and you do not want to do that. He's quoted saying, I have never seen anyone die from an autological argument. Very humorous writer. What are we... A lot of squabbling when there's a lot of potential on the line. What if doctors were actually using anatomy to practice physiology? What's the point of even naming all the bones and the muscles if nobody's putting that to work? He went as far to say, Galileo pondering whether the sun revolves around the earth, in the grand scheme, is irrelevant, and he is held in the highest regards, science greater than philosophy. These things don't matter. They just had really big news drop at the CERN, the Hadron Collider, and they're like, this could undo the past 50 years of quantum physics. Well, that's good to know. Nobody's still working on chemical imbalances in the brain. He says, paradoxically, people want to die because they say life isn't worth living. But at the same time, there's a lot of people out there going, this idea is worth dying for. We're going to get much deeper. It's all a matter of framing. Camus wedging in there early, you got to find something worth dying for. You're already in the existential prism. It's going to get more reflective. If your car ever breaks down on the highway, just know that you could call Albert Camus. He's got despair. Getting to the middle half of the chapter, have you ever heard that Viktor Frankl quote? It's about suffering, and he compares it to the vacuum of the soul. Like living in soul-crushing poverty, like most people in the world, sub-Saharan Africa, you pass out mining every day. You will feel despair will fill any empty space in your humanity that you don't fill. If you stare into the abyss, it'll stare back. You have to give yourself the meaning. Otherwise, suffering is just relative. Middle part of the chapter, Camus brought up, there has never been a national or even a public discourse about suicide. Think about Soviet Russia. People were depressed for sure. And they sum it up with, be a man. You think you lack endorphins and dopamine? This is irrelevant. Anhedonia, chronic depression. I think you are faking, little bitch. Camus is like, we're never supposed to talk about this, but this question festers in the mind of every man. He called it the silencing of the heart until one evening he eventually pulls the trigger or jumps. The subconscious, we're pushing this deep into the shadow. And especially as a nation, we have like a subconscious on a grander scale. What do you think happens when you lock people in their houses for a year? We see record numbers of suicide. Camus says he knew a Russian man whose daughter died, and he spent 5 years just like, you know, this isn't supposed to happen. How could this happen to a man? He finally killed himself. Camus is like, wow, this is within all of us. Even people that do have other kids, they need to... Later chapters are about a lot of people give themselves meaning by reproducing. Quote here, another poetic one. The worm in the man's heart. One must follow and undress this fatal game that leads from lucidity in the face of existence, flight from light. We want to run away from these big questions. Just ignore it. It'll go away, right? It's kind of like a mini Dunning-Kruger effect. I'll have pictures on the YouTube. It's a quick lesson. As you begin to wake up throughout your life, you think, oh, I'm so much smarter than all these idiots out here. And then you start to realize how little you know about everything else and why there's experts, because you could really only have enough time to learn about one thing in your life. And that is called the Valley of Despair. And this lasts for years. It's a much less drastic curve. You just got to claw your way out, learn slowly, knowing your place in the universe now. The worm in the man's heart. He's going to every man contemplates suicide. The ones that take their life contemplate it halfway. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. I'm telling you, contemplate away. But you have to contemplate to completion if you are ever going to start this journey inward. Otherwise, just throw your sunglasses on. Do not look at the light. It's really some allegory of the cave stuff here, called the process of illuminating the mind. And notice he keeps saying man in all this, man's heart. It's because over 90% of suicides are men. It's got to be all of our male privilege. He said, in the melodrama of life, killing yourself amounts to confessing. So that stern Russian culture is actually living a lie. The melodrama of life, of course, all the philosophers say the world is a stage, keep your mask on. Ego disillusion is much healthier, less people dying in gulags. The way to deal with it is the absurd. More of the second and the third chapter. Remember Meursault from The Stranger? That was an absurd concept. They were putting a guy on death row who didn't care whether or not he lived. How do you punish a man who doesn't know that he's being punished? It's all this melodrama of life. Your wife tells you the same story every morning. You laugh along. You don't run down the hallway and jump out the window. It's show business. These existential philosophers repeat it age after age. These are 6,000-year-old ideas. If Camus managed a band, it would be called The Suicide Solution. You can acknowledge that life is meaningless without taking the leap. Should take us to chapter 2. You get the point. We should be having this discussion. Absurd walls. He starts this chapter like an astrologist ex-girlfriend, some of us might have. He goes, deep feelings always mean more than they're conscious of saying. The regularity of an impulse or a repulsion in the soul is encountered again in habits of doing or thinking. That gut feeling, all these philosophers try to talk about it. The chick that's doing Reiki on you is onto something. Nietzsche called it your operari. Thomas Hobbes called it your endeavor, the sum whole of your will. Camus is calling this the repulsion of the soul. It's all your feelings, your instincts. It knows more of where you want to be than your linguistic brain that has 20,000 words that can try to communicate to the rest of your body with. You know there's neurons in your gut and in your heart? Those can't. Imagine if your heart could talk to you, and men have neurons in the tip of their penis. So yes, our dicks do talk to us. All these actually, the Bible rips off Plato, and then every other philosopher rips them off thereon after. It's the quote, watch your thoughts, they become your words. Watch your Words, they become actions. Watch your actions. They become habits. Watch your hobbits. They become characters. Watch your character. It becomes your destiny. Great feelings carry the weight of their own universe, says Camus. You ever see Pirates of the Caribbean? Captain Jack Sparrow doesn't have a plan in life, but he finds that compass. Maybe it stands for his moral compass. Doesn't understand where it's bringing him, but as long as he follows his moral compass, it leads him to what he desires most in life. It's kind of like all of these feelings that you can't put into words. Camus says your attitude of mind is part of the whole metaphysical self. I know it sounds like I'm going to start debriefing you on your chakras. This is where, like, Engel, Hegel, Karl Marx, they go off the road. They start saying, none of your ideas are yours. You're part of the bigger plan. There is no I. It's a deterministic philosophy. Victorianism versus Romanticism. Are we humans that have our own ideas? Camus obviously thinks so, because we can contemplate taking our own lives. You're not seeing rabbits doing that. Men are judged by the totality of their deeds. And all of these feelings, it doesn't matter in the greater picture. So he's still acknowledging, I don't care what you think that you're working towards. It's still, you're judged by other men by what you do. I said Camus runs in these Hollywood circles. He says, meeting actors hundreds of times, and they were able to bullshit him, he was still able to tell what kind of a person this was by what they spend their time doing. You might define yourself by your impulses and your goals. Ultimately, that's how you're going to make sense looking back on your life. It's still not reality. He's kind of getting into, like, reality tunnels here. Spouted off in the first chapter about not caring how many circuits of thinking there are. It's all to say that you can make these decisions. He started talking about art, but there's a later chapter on that. Basically, art doesn't matter. It's all so meta that they're commenting on, watch Exit Through the Gift Shop. Art is money laundering. Camus is like, the only true art is living. You want to paint on the canvas of life. Mid-chapter, just as all thoughts have a beginning, the best deeds come from somewhere as well. We do not acknowledge these. We like to sell fear on the news, but we won't talk about how this is stressing people out, leading them to take lives. He was going, I have my best ideas on street corners and revolving doors. There's so much potential. Where's the story going to go? I have my own choose your own adventure. How come you didn't write one of those young adult literature? You could have cashed out. He was going, people who attempt suicide and fail see this as a new starting point. I know way too many people, at least four. My first encounter, you probably shouldn't have done this. It was in public education, middle school. They had this guy come to our auditorium. He had a failed suicide attempt on the Golden Gate Bridge. He was going, the second your feet leave the railing, you regret it. And the entire way down, you're thinking, I wish I could take it back. That's what Camus was saying. They see this as a fresh start. He calls this a revolt of the flesh. Another good band name. And it is completely absurd. That guy's flying through the air at terminal velocity. His gut is like, oh no, baby, what is you doing? Your brain, it thinks it got it all figured out. Camus was the guy, when there was a jumper on the top of the building, he would yell up, do a flip! Revolt of the flesh. He said this is one of the most artistic expressions. Damn! I think it might be Avenged Sevenfold. They have that album. The cover is a monk burning himself. They did this during the Vietnam War to protest. People sat outside the Pentagon and lit themselves on fire. That'll get the news's attention. We're not making statements out of our death. That chapter one thing. We're not choosing things to die for. A revolt of the flesh. We just talked about Robin Williams. His art holds up because he killed himself. Nirvana songs still go hard. It's absurd to not obey the one rule of life. Don't jump off the bridge with your friends. Improvise, adapt, overcome, survive. I don't really feel like it. He said, like those attempts gives you a revival, intense periods in nature have a significant effect on humans. So he's saying we're disconnected. What kills people early? Stress. It causes heart complications, the number one cause of death in this country. We are super disconnected with the Schumann frequency, you know, the resonance of the earth is naturally tuned into the human. The further we get away from nature, the sadder we get. The NASA nerds. Oh my God, quantum binary universe string theory. We're like so irrelevant. They love it. People want to be meaningless. It takes away any sort of responsibility. Camus is in this period of war. Of course, soldiers get depressed so hard they get PTSD. When we started to urbanize, you saw serial killers and an uptick in suicide. It's all this counter-human stuff. NASA guys are striving to be aliens. We're going to have melancholy astronauts. Yeah, I guess Mars is cool. These meaningless pantomimes of daily life, the mundane absurdity that it really is, can throw you for a loop. I've been watching that History Channel show Alone. Like, they make it out into the woods. Some people are like, this is the way to live, but obviously you need people. Better example, the 1980s documentaries, Koyaanisqatsi. Philip Glass is the composer. Koyaanisqatsi. You gotta watch these. And it's mandatory that you take mushrooms before. This is the guy that scored The Truman Show. They got musical recognition. It's beautiful music. It starts you out in the rice paddies, and it goes all the way to the day-to-day life in these Chinese super cities. And you see, it's like a Ken Burns documentary. There's these indigenous people, and they zoom in with the camera on their eyes. The people that have nothing will die of disease, allegedly, at an earlier age. They're happy, and the people just look like they're in distress, chiefing cigarettes, squatting, drinking vodka. Coping mechanisms and tech, going to the moon, signing up to be shot to Mars. They need to make a Discovery Channel show about that. That ain't the suicide solution. You have to recognize our displacement. That's what it means in Hopi. Powakatsi, we are displaced. We learned from Beyond Good and Evil. The defeatist mentality is indifference. Even if you are passing out in the stone quarry in Sudan, and you have a community and a family, being in these 90-story walk-ups in your own one apartment type of thing is why we're seeing this suicide epidemic. Second half of the chapter here really defines these absurd walls, and he's starting to talk about how we can cope with this displacement. He quotes Aristotle, who probably put it best in the last 3,000 years. On the level of science, a theory can describe the world, but it cannot ultimately explain it. The world is made up of such diversity, and there are so many different perspectives we can take on understanding it, that it seems futile that we should ever find one absolute truth. One reason that we hope to apply to the world is not the world itself. Therefore, the world is fundamentally irrational. At the deepest level, Aristotle might have just been looking through too many telescopes, sat around too many burning acacia bushes. He's like, at the deepest root sciences, we know that there are anomalies, just like the Large Hadron Collider with the God particle. We still can't explain these things. The truth is really a little bit of everything. It's a sprinkle of nihilism, a dash of optimism, and a whole lot of realism. Socrates built off of Aristotle's work. His catchphrase was, "Know thyself." If everyone understood their own biases and that they only have a little fraction of the truth, it would make communication and collaboration a whole lot easier. And then for the last part of the chapter, he went off the deep end, more in that science stuff. All the philosophers have to take a shot at science. First chapter was calling out the other philosophers. This was 1940, the atomic age. Camus was like, is anybody paying attention? We just renamed atoms two electrons. And now we have quarks are the new electrons, and that they're down to gluons, and then positive and negative. We just rename it. We keep going deeper and deeper, the plum pudding model. Remember Jimmy Neutron when we were kids? We thought electrons spun around the nucleus. No, it's a cloud, and we can't even... No one's ever seen an electron. This is what Camus is like. Kierkegaard, Schiller, everybody was saying there's a high dose of absurdity in science. Think Albert Einstein. He was shunned by the scientific community because he talked about relativity. There are these absurdist walls. If you try to obey too hard to the sciences, you are going to become an atheist, which is just as dogmatic as religion. Later chapter, final quote here. Absurdist walls arise in the confrontation between the human need and the unreasonable silence of the world. We got to fill the dead air with one another and talk about these deeper issues. Chapter 3, end of the first act, and a really deep one. It's called Philosophical Suicide. It's all about putting your brain on a shelf. Just like a creepy hippie, it's going to start to pickle. You have all those weird vinegars. Starts this one saying, for philosophers, it is career suicide to discuss killing yourself, like playing briefly out in the storm, hoping not to get struck by lightning. Guy thinks he's Edgar Allan Poe sometimes. Camus, once again, saying how ridiculous his own circle of academics is. You see this if you spend your life in the ivory tower, believing someone else without proof is joining an ideology. Show me the electron! If you can pray enough, meditate enough, and locate your own Jack Sparrow moral compass, that makes you ethical. When you follow someone else's ideology or set of rules or religion, you are being obedient. You are not being ethical. A lot of philosophers out there are just following other people's dogma. They're not saying anything questionable. Like, as a comedian, if you're not causing any bit of controversy, you're not walking the line enough. What are you saying? Check out the Patreon page. Madness of Crowd got censored. Philosophers won't even touch on this edgy topic of suicide. How brave. Camus called this a virtue of disproportion. Another one of these absurdities, how we push the people to the fringes who need the most help. Like the homeless people are shooting up on the streets because we don't allow them to have drugs in the homeless shelters. Why are we paying for homeless shelters then? It's extreme camping and you're allowed to do drugs. Another good Discovery Channel show. The virtues of disproportion are all around us. Camus goes, the most absurd thing I see in my time is a man with a sword charging at machine guns. Stalingrad was going down. They were sending out two Russian guys with one Moisen Nagat. When comrade dies, you pick up his rifle and fight for Mother Russia. It's absurd, man, the things that people will do for their country. Camus is suggesting suicide by cop. You gotta make a statement if you're gonna take your life. But don't do it. Keep on reading. Yeah, you might be lost in the third chapter. Don't give up on the book. You can't close the book halfway, people. People that don't finish books are at a higher risk for suicide. Fact. The absurd is a divorce from the scrutiny of real life, he says. Escapism. Take a step away, call a timeout before you flip the Monopoly board. It's the equivalent of suicide. You're gonna send ripples and ruin your other pal's game more than you know it. He gets deep in this midpoint of the chapter here, and it's about the thesis again, these philosophical suicide. Not just philosophers do it by ignoring the hard questions or difficult premises. People commit philosophical suicide by putting their brain on the shelf, and this is obeying the religion of the day, which is really scientism. You know, if I point out a Fauci flop to someone, they get cognitive dissonance and get mad at me. He said, think about it. Oh my God, man, we ignore the entire epidemic of suicide because we're too fragile or probably just lazy to understand the truth. And Camus said a man is always a prey to his truths. Once he admitted them, he cannot free himself from them. A man who has become conscious to the absurd is forever bound to it. That Dunning-Kruger effect. If you're not trying to dig all the way to China, stay out of the manhole. People don't want to be bound to the truth. I think there's like hybrid humans, a lot of ostriches. Their defense mechanism is to stick their head in the sand, and you take the jab in the ass from there. You're forever bound to the absurd. Further, people will suppress your voice so that they don't have to think and they could just be told what to do. Who let the dogma out? The tricky part is staying on the bright side about it and holding on to hope. Because once you give up hope, you're mentally taking yourself out of future projections of reality. Sorry to do it on you, metaphysical, but thoughts shape reality. Once you stop exercising your hope muscles, there is no future out there. You have to will this shit into existence, like Hobbes said. Thinking of escape inherently is going to cause an existential undertide in your psyche over time. You think you got it all figured out. Better to have an open dialogue. And once you take the leap, you can't go back. Like Mr. Golden Gate Bridge, who scarred me. Go back and listen to Replay, we debriefed. First ever fiction book on Nick's nonfiction. This guy kills himself and gets trapped in a time loop. You don't want that happening to you. Oh, yes, I'm an atheist. I know when I die, I go into a black void of comfort. Motherfucker, you need to try DMT. Atheists, bro, you are in your own cult. Are you sure? You are going to get trapped in a Ken Grimwood time loop. maybe Christians are right, and you do kill yourself. You just committed yourself to eternal damnation. Lucifer has your endless soul. Because you couldn't wait 80 short years to just find out. Wait till the end of the show. You're going to be the asshole who has to answer his phone in the middle. Camus commenting on Chekhov's work. Recognition of the absurd can bring on existential transcendence. You don't have to worry about, am I going to kill myself? Am I not? You transcend to the plane of commentary. You're in the peanut gallery. That guy's really going to shoot himself out of a cannon. This is a wild show to partake in, and you only get 80 years here. It's all about framing. Imagine you go to the therapist one day, you unload on him. God, I'm in a bad place, man. Nothing matters. Nobody cares about me. Your therapist, if you're paying him the right money, he's going to frame it right. Matters. Cares. Nobody cares about you. Nothing matters. Just roll with it. The absurdist school of improv. Paint on the canvas of life. So hard to say. I've spent tens of hours on the phone with my bank. I fucking wanna throw food at customers. You know, you have your bad days. Small wins. Camus, this painting on the portrait of life, it's a little outdated. You are the director. You have an HD camera for your own life, your own two eyes. Frame the story how you want. Don't let other people frame it for you, too. That's the dangerous part, and life might just pass you by because you think, yep, God's got it all taken care of for me. I have the religious insurance policy. This could be heaven. Chekhov, also with another bombshell. This has got to be one of my favorite quotes. If we haven't found the sadness solution yet, then the answer obviously lies within something that has been made off limits. We're going to just keep ignoring the fact as a society that psilocybin cures chronic depression. Yeah, good thing you could marry your cousin in more states than you could smoke a joint. I mean, MDMA trials over 50% chronic depression cured. These soldiers need to go to raves. Remember Hamlet? This king kills himself with oodles of comic relief. Camus was picking up his Shakespearean ball. I'll loop those points back in. Comedy is about acknowledging the inequities in society and commenting on the counterculture as art is supposed to do. Camus saying it doesn't matter if you're punching down or punching up as long as you're punching society. And the comedic genre, why Hamlet hit so hard, we still have to read, is because comedy used to be called the theater of the absurd. I bet you didn't know that. A little behind the scenes into where Camus got his work from. He's ripping off Shakespeare. I was way too dumb for that in high school. I got to try to go back. But think about it. Through most of time, the only way to live knowing that the king, the sultan, has his boot on your neck is with a little bit of satire. It's corny. Medicine for a lot of people is laughter throughout the history of time. Koyanis katsi. Those people laugh with yellow teeth and yellow irises. Shouts out Kierkegaard for his last thesis in the chapter. This guy wrote about extreme fear of religious punishment from a young age. And he said religious is good for making people dumb, superstitious, and doubled up with anxiety while stifling your critical thinking. There's no way I could put it better than just you're putting your brain in your backpack and throwing on the holy angel halo when that shit might not even be real either. Maybe the Muslims are right. I need to strap a bomb to my chest. Kierkegaard knew from a young age seeing what is true and what is not is different than seeking what is desirable. And a lot of people never come to terms with this. They think the point of life is to be happy. But the nihilists think that the point of life is suffering. It's somewhere in the middle. Maybe it's Buddhism. The point of life is to learn lessons. Or you could just kick back and get your heavenly insurance policy. The premiums are high for Jewish heaven. Even in Buddhism, you gotta enlighten yourself if you want to ascend. The Christians are playing a game of karma as well. Oh, I owe 10 Hail Marys. I gotta go to penance this week. It was Hobbes who said that religion is a self-help mechanism gone wrong. Something along those lines. You can use them to your advantage. Camus not being as nice with it. Same with Kierkegaard. He hashtag destroys the radical left here. To lighten it up at the end of the chapter. A quote to saying that everything is privileged is tantamount to saying that everything is equivalent. We got a currency of oppression in America. Maybe that's why highest developed country, highest suicide per capita. Using privilege as this karma meter is just another form of cultural Marxism, religion. Ended on a bigger quote, pushing the exigence of existential distress deeper into our social subconscious, maybe manifesting in the restrictive world. Puritanism. We're marrying our cousins, but you can't giggle off a joint with a pal. If we don't illuminate suicide, these waves are going to grow, and there's going to be these tidal waves that just annihilate perfectly good people. Chapter 4, Absurd Freedom. Running with this idea of foregoing your own freedoms, because along with freedom comes responsibility. Thomas Jefferson said, most people would prefer a peaceful enslavement to a dangerous freedom. Camus, on this same track of logic, now that you know how to recognize the absurd, you can embrace the chaos. Utopia is supposed to be a balance of chaos and order. It's not supposed to be the giver. Brave new world, you have everything. Humans need obstacles to overcome. Camus is saying if you know how to recognize the absurd, you can embrace the chaos. Again, with the not letting disenfranchised people have a word at the table, I think it's Martin Luther King who said, a riot is the voice of the unheard. Absurd that we're not talking about these things. We gotta give the people the ability to discuss it, an open hotline or whatever. Mid-chapter is saying if you're a cat among other cats or a tree in the forest, you wouldn't feel despair. The reason that we feel disconnected is because we think, and people who think more are more disconnected. what every human has in common, even the lemming masses, is hope. It's part of the human spirit. You see old ladies buying lotto tickets everywhere. Depression is the sickness of surrendering hope. More of this not hitting your hope muscles. I'm telling you, man, I've had fun connections with people. You need these as well, where you walk by them and same frequency. You're both making the flat face at each other, deadpan stare. Look at these people. Look around us. What the fuck are we doing here? That's good to have that connection, but if you got all sad boys in your circle, it's going to suck the ever-living life out of you. No negative energy. The sophists did find a little bit of truth. Media is pushing all of this fear tactics. We should be using our biggest voices to be championing hope. We're just confusing people. Like, together alone, that has to be one of the most blatant double-speak absurdities ever. New normal. Camus would have had the Joker condition. I can't stop laughing. In today's world, all the absurdities. Remember, there is a positive story at the end of this. Sisyphus is going to save us. Gandhi said, "Strength does not come from physical capacity, but from an indomitable will." Camus says, great piece of advice. All it takes to persist is admitting to oneself the meaning is not obvious. It's Platonism. We don't know. Just stick it out. You can do it, man. 80 years really ain't a long time. It's actually more optimistic to say we don't know the meaning than to say there is no meaning. You gotta stay away from these atheists, I'm telling you. It's a tailspin of a way to look at the world. They gotta have Christopher Sitchin's, the deity of atheism, take some dimethyltryptamine. He's gonna come back from hyperspace after talking to the creator. Camus admits that it would be absurd not to mention people who have killed themselves have surrendered at a pretty high level. Kind of right, but again, I'm the creator. I'm going to choose when I die. Same thing with atheism, saying that you know that there's nothing out there. Agnosticism makes so much more sense. Ends this one with a personal strong point. Camus met a man who voluntarily went to a Siberian gulag because he didn't want to pay his mortgage, get the tags on his license renewed. The monotony of life, it will suck the soul out of you if you don't have access to mushrooms once a year. This guy, he gave up his freedom because he knew there are different types of prison. Freedom is slavery. Did you know, this is another bombshell fact you could drop on people, a majority of plantation slaves refused emancipation. Black rednecks, white liberals, go read it. That some of the real history, people really do prefer a comfortable enslavement to a risky freedom. It's not a great sign for a red-blooded American. Like some of the listeners we have, freedom requires vigilance. Let's walk the line here. I'm going to quote one of my favorite places. Abrecht macht frei. Find out where these words are posted above. Work shall set you free. Camus, you gotta breathe into your life meaning. Why are you gonna go to a gulag? Build something of your own. You have the tools out here to do it. That guy was just a friggin' dunce. Camus bought up sleep. He's like, bro, just use that as your time for escape. Teach yourself how to lucid dream, and then you could fly all over the world, learn how to astral project, get out of the prison cell. There's other ways to do it. It's the biggest, you're trapped in your own mind, man. Don't jump. I wish you would step back from that ledge, my friend. That should be the opening to the show. In the theme of persistence, he ended on, it's not who did the best living, but who did the most living. Some people are rich in resources, other people are rich in life experiences. And I'll let you guess what people wish they had more of when they're on their deathbed. Live hard, live fast, and live a lot. It's the quantity of life experiences. It doesn't matter what it looks like in your retirement home. Are you going to be able to come to terms with how you spent your time? Transitioning off the absurd, it's a very, very helpful tool to try to find a bit of peace in the world of suffering. Chapter 5, The Absurd Man, hits a little Dostoyevsky, his book Demons, a quote: if Strevogin believes, he does not think he believes. If he does not believe, he does not think he does not believe. Another one of these paradoxes, we read Annika Harris's book Conscious very early on. She had a great comparison. Consciousness is like a butterfly. It can land on you. If you pay attention for too long, it'll fly away. So maybe it's not that good of a comparison. Think of it like autopilot. You could turn it on and off. Camus' point, much better, if you dig too deep on your own beliefs, you're going to start undermining your own foundations. Again, ask yourself, do you really want to go deeper? More Dunning-Kruger effect. Middle chapter we'll skip to. Another career suicide, quote, posterity seems to transcend all ethics. You cannot say this as a philosopher. Do you know what posterity means? The well-off of future generations. Posterity transcends ethics. You got Karen. You can't say that. My baby. Why are we debt spending? Why are we $28 trillion? We like to say that we think about the future, but every action we take proves otherwise. He dipped his toe into antinatalism. Think about it if you bought this to a standard ethics review board. You know this clusterfuck of a world we got going on? Your country's fiscally in debt to the Chinese Communist Party. I'm gonna shit two or three more people into this, imprint my crappy dogma onto them, play with them for the fun 18 years of their life, and then renounce all responsibility. Posterity is an excuse for our biological engine. We just, like our sum whole of goods, our repulsion of the soul, we're just trying to continue the human race out here. You could tell yourself that we're implementing a democracy slowly. Utopia's right around the corner. Probably just passing the baton along to the AI. Posterity is a myth. I'm dropping bombs out here, Camus. More of this, someone who follows their own morals is ethical. Someone who follows an existing set of rules is obedient. Think about the guys on trial in Nuremberg. They never questioned or had a moral compass of their own. They just followed what everybody else was doing. Obedience is actually amoral. I will say it, the popular opinion is in favor of censorship right now. These rights are self-evident. They're given to us by God, the freedom of speech. It is amoral a lot of times to be obedient. The absurd man is actually the one who has never retrieved his compass from Davy Jones. Fulfill, become your self-actualized man, you have to enter the abyss. And to draw a bigger point to it, like, I've had friends' dads who have committed suicide, and people in your town. This is a terrible point to make. It's true, though, and I have a younger audience, so people will resonate with this. These people kill themselves in record numbers. Guys that aren't getting laid, they get married, and they fucking... You need to get a job, you need to get a wife, you need to have a house. Yeah, so I have high blood pressure, and I contemplate putting the 38 special in my mouth every night. Come on, that is dogmatic. You are not finding your own moral compass. So he's reinforcing here, you have to utilize hope. It is absurd to have a dream, but those who utilize absurdism can will their absurd visions. It's better to have a vision than a dream. That's so Raven. Check out here, looking into the future. She was a philosopher. Chapter 6 here is a fun one. It's called Don Juanism, talking about sex, coming from the Don of Pole himself, Albert Camus. And this is actually a good segue. I was saying the guys who get married, they're grown men who are involuntarily celibate. Incels are supposed to be an endangered species. Camus says, if it were sufficient to live, things would be too easy. The more one loves, the stronger the absurd grows. It's going to be absurd to get your heart broken, but this is going to be living to the max. Fall in love as many times as you can. Get a divorce. The more that you love, expands your capacity for that emotion. People are so starved for compliments. It's because love is an endangered species right now. These things are very special, and we just ignore them. We got record porn addiction numbers, which is like proven to shrink your prefrontal cortex. Suicide. Cheems. You go to horny jail. Don Juan is quoted with, why should it be essential to love rarely in order to love much? All of these Ovid the love poet rom-com lines. When you love, love gently. When you kiss her, kiss passionately. You could kiss passionately and gently. Rom-com, you could get a girl and get the dream job. I only allow dirty talk in my bedroom if all of the assertions are sound and the premises are valid. Babe, I want you to finish everywhere. Well, actually, it'd be physically impossible for me to cover every item in this room in seminal fluid. What an a priori concept. Don't be getting your life advice from poems or fictional movies. Bigger point here is that, you know, we're all being stingy with the love. Think about social media. Might be Russian bots, outside influence, but we focus on our differences instead of our similarities. Early 2008 internet motto was find your tribe. Now it's get radicalized. We've castrated ourselves as a society from we're detached from even sex. It used to be like one in 1,000 kids were born with autism, and now it's 1 in 8. These people on the spectrum aren't upping the sex numbers. Man, these like TLC shows are championing the wrong thing, as we need to champion love. There are shows about people who are passing on their genetics. What was that MTV show Next? We need those old dating shows. Let's start getting people laid again. Tinder is now a gatekeeper. They limit how many people you can match with, who you can see. What the hell are these algorithms even doing good for? We're detaching ourselves from sex. The story of Don Juan, too. He was stoned in the public square because he had sex with one of the ladies in the prince's harem. They had all these puritanical town folk throwing the rocks, and Don Juan was like, you guys are fucking hypocrites. I'm kind of happy to be going out the suicide by cop here, because I lived how all of you subconsciously also wish that you could live. Free, thinking of sex, love, as a renewable resource. It's not a limited thing that you have to wager for items. It's the Faustian argument. Remember, the guy wanted to write the best play in existence, so he made a deal with the devil, and he sold his soul. And the point of Faust is everybody saw the play and was like, I wish I could have written that. Everybody would sell their soul. Everybody would do their fucking... Everybody wants to be big and famous, but we love to cancel each other. It's absurd. Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. I'm quoting the Bible now, the end of this chapter. Our relationship to sex is very absurd. Sexual pleasure is part of the metaphysical self, just acting like we're not actually closer to bonobos than chimpanzees is theft. You're lying to people about where they came from. The ultimate end is negligible, like you said in that first chapter. Why are we going to talk about if the earth is round or flat? Let's figure out if we should kill ourselves or not. Chapter 7 is called Drama. You're getting Shakespearean. Started with a quote. The play is the thing where I'll catch the consciousness of the king. This is a Hamlet line. You can notice by the rhyme. the play is the thing where I'll catch the consciousness of the king. There's 10 layers to every single sentence in Shakespeare. Camus chose to focus on the word catch. I will catch the consciousness this time around of the king. It's like Anna was saying, we're never able to catch the bug. Maybe if this is a reincarnatory wheel, this is the time that I'm going to be the big famous actor. It's never going to happen. Are you born into the Leo DiCaprio Matt Damon? Damon means demon in the Roman language. I could start talking like a preacher now, an hour in. He said the fame of an actor is the highest form of human drama. And it's obvious that it exists in your town as well. There's the town bicycle. She low-key likes being the whore because everybody's talking about her. Doesn't matter. Donald Trump said it doesn't matter if they're talking good or bad as long as they're talking. In 10,000 years, Camus said, Goethe, his name is going to be gone with all of the churches that he assembled. We don't know people who built the 7 architectural wonders of the world. Sign on to the Patreon page. We're doing a deep dive on that soon. Your name is going to be gone. But being self-centered this chapter, he's like, writers have the ability to have their work live on forever. Trashes actors a little bit more. If an actor doesn't succeed, he is forgotten about within his own lifetime. Before his big point prefaces it more, actors play themselves, comedians play other people. He was in the time of, shit man, who was the guy, New York City, Lenny Bruce, the actual real comedians who were getting arrested for what they said on stage. Camus was like, you're playing yourselves as a comic, it is a journey inward as a writer. And we don't know one actor from Shakespeare's era. Jack Nicholas is only known because he worked with Kubrick. They had the best director of theater of all time, William Shakespeare. We don't know one actor from that timeline. We remember writers from 6,000 years ago. People who put into words what the pulse of the time is are doing a service to everybody and putting a bookmark in time and actually leaving information for the next people to pick up. Camus said an actor has more in common with a traveler than a writer. You drain the script or the people around you and you move on to the next place. Authors keep on digging. They try to undermine their own foundation. He said very beautifully, better than I just put it, writers are mimes of the ephemeral, whereas actors are mimes of people. Mimes of the ephemeral. Another good band name. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mimes of the Ephemeral. That sounded more strip club DJ than band name. Pretty cool chapter about drama, knowing how ingrained Camus was with 1940s, the golden age of Hollywood. He's like, these people are sophists. Pay attention to who's writing the stories. Chapter 8 is called Conquest. I'm about to get controversial to start this one off. Manliness. It's not about being a provider, protecting your family from harm. For all of history, being a man was about spreading your seed, besting opponents, claiming territory, conquest. There have always been breeders and there have always been explorers. There's really cool studies about the Homo sapiens being successful because the few that would risk going over the mountains, finding out what was on the other side. Conquest, the chapter is about. Beware of those who say, I know this too well to be able to express it. I've seen it a million times. Well, if you can't tell me what's going on here, you don't actually know what the deal is. Camus is like, use your words. What did Woody Allen say? Those who can't do, teach. Those who can't teach, teach Jim. If you can't explain anything, you can't be a teacher. Like the Bitcoin bros. Ethereum is the future, bro. Who is mining this? Who is Satoshi Nakamoto? When can you... How do you cash out if you don't have Wi-Fi? Anybody could start a new hobby. It's those who stick through the good and bad parts that are able to conquer this domain. Drops another Russian cliche on us. A man is more of a man through the things he keeps to himself than to the things that he says. Silence speaks much louder than words. I like that more than actions. Another good quote here. Conquerors know that action is in itself useless, for the path of struggle leads me to the flesh. Even humiliated, the flesh is my only certainty. Albert's got a real management mentality. Conquerors don't do the action themselves. 48 laws of power, you got to manipulate people to do the work for you. That's how people have built empires over the time. I'm not sure how all this tied into the theater of the absurd. Could be another potential solution that professors could be working on, why men have nothing to try to overcome conquest, and maybe that's why we're killing ourselves. Chapter 9 we're going to go to. It's called Absurd Creation. And this one's about art, saying we have art in order not to die of the truth. That would be the true escapism, not the absurdisms. Good art takes you out of the thing. I really can't suggest it enough. Koyaanis Katsi, Kowyaanisqatsi. It's worth the Google. Cook up those edibles. For the absurd man, life is not a matter of explaining and solving. Life is a matter of experiencing and describing. You want to be the absurd creator. They say in therapy, if you get deep, there are like levels and bosses, I swear. One of them, they tell you to get into miniatures. It's absurd creation. You feel like you have taken back a little bit of control. The last chapter overlaps with Aesop's Fables. There's that rapper Aesop. He's got the song Kirby. And it talks about therapy. The hook of it is, man, I don't know, maybe get a kitten. Doc said, I don't know, maybe get a kitten. He was like, I went to therapy. We had philosophical and existential debates for weeks. I paid him good money. And the last thing he said to me was, have you tried getting a cat? Absurd creation. We have to feel like we are in control. I boss this thing around. I'm higher in the hierarchy. That's the canvas of life. Or you could really try to create more than you consume on a more micro scale rather than just this frilly dancing everywhere you go. I think one of the most absurd people of our lifetime, Anthony Bourdain, another man who killed himself. He was working on a pedophilia documentary at the time. This guy experienced more cultures of the world than anyone, ingrained himself. We need Bourdainism. That is a way to fill the air with life. He also said in this chapter about art, if art is a mirror of the self and the self can't be absurd, how can there be absurdist art? He's trying to say everybody is going to mimic my thought process. Very full of himself, you're saying. Pablo Picasso owes Albert Camus' estate a crap load of money. Absurd paintings. This guy got so old, he started losing it, and he's putting blocks where his eyeballs should be. He really did influence an entire genre of art. He revived the counterculture movement. All of this, like, Victorian art was just painting bridges and crap. And then they had modern art. You have Andy Warhol just advertising Campbell's. Absurd art is some of the real deal. And I'm not saying abstract. That's money laundering. Absurd countercultural take. That is art for you. Let's go to chapter 10 here. This one is again on Dostoyevsky before our final myth. This one's called Kirillov. Piggybacking off of some existential points for Dostoyevsky. There either is a God, a life after death, and life has meaning, or life has no meaning, everything we do is pointless, and life is little more than a cruel joke. So he just mixed, I don't want to confuse people, that quote kind of sucks, but he just mixed together existentialism, absurdism, and nihilism. That's basically all of Dostoevsky's characters, though. They're lost in this mix of, like, transitionhood. the point here is, like, Albert Camus' first book, The Stranger, was through all these characters he told the story. So when you read a Dostoevsky, Kirillov, these people represent one of these philosophies. So it really isn't news to anybody, but he's picking up that existential balls. Said Dost definitely wrestled with absurd themes, and he ultimately placed his faith in God. So this does, in the end, make him an existentialist. I'm trying to put these into some sort of ways for the listeners who are really interested in learning. I got this woman in the UK that we do phone calls and talk philosophy. People are offering for me to teach English now. Think Albert Camus, absurd. Dostoevsky, existentialist. Nietzsche, the nihilist. This chapter talked about Ivan Karamazov, which is Dostoevsky's main character in his magnum opus, Brothers Karamazov. Just a really good commentary on how atheism and how it absolutely pwns young men. I think you got it figured out. Watch that show alone, man. People, nature will communicate you and tell you what you need to know. Late show here. I've been getting into cryptids as well. Not cryptocurrency. Bigfoot, dog man. Nah, there's some real wild stories. We're going to do missing 411 books. Like that show out in the wilderness long enough, you're going to start talking to yourself. You're going to start thinking you're hearing things that you have needed to. Or you could just take that mushroom trip, cure your depression, and we could be on our merry way as a society advance. Chapter 11, The Myth of Sisyphus. This is not a tall tale American cryptid. Sisyphus was the Yeti, the Bigfoot of Mount Olympus. By this point, you probably forgot what you came to the book for. It's kind of like the labyrinth of life. Sisyphus was a mortal man who stole some divine knowledge from the top of Mount Olympus, and the gods found out, and they gave him the worst punishment of all time, to push a boulder up a hill for eternity. Kind of like the Prometheus story, flew too close to the sun, got burned, trying to advance. Sisyphus, he was sent to the underworld for a long time beforehand. He trained his sister. They sent her all the way to Jupiter. That's the part that mirrors Aesop's fables. Guy clawed his way out of the underworld, returned to his wife, left his wife to sail the Mediterranean. He's like Odysseus. He's all of the mythos in one. Camus, he got more philosophical. We covered most of the points about having this passion for life, kind of flipping off the gods. They sent you to the ghetto, but you clawed it out. He's still going to adventure, even though it's immoral to leave your wife. You have to follow your own compass. Putting all the themes of the book together, the repulsion of the soul. Brother, if the descent contains sorrow, that means there is a certain level of joy that is to be attained. Sisyphus's punishment is the worst because it is a mundane task. He knows that when he gets to the top of the hill, the boulder crushes him and rolls back down to the bottom, and he's got to push it right back up. There is no end point. He knows that it doesn't serve a bigger purpose. The point is that Sisyphus is most happy while he is pushing the boulder. Or at least after time, you gotta convince yourself to be happy. Find an absurd way to. He's a bodybuilder. He's going toe-to-toe at the competition with Atlas, the guy that holds up the globe. Think about when you're really close to finishing a project. Just like Sisyphus, you got the boulder really close to the top of the hill. And then you finish it. You have this pit in your stomach. The void is starting to call back to you. Accomplishments, living for happiness, might not be what it's all about. You have to start to enjoy, Objekt macht frei, the work will be the thing that sets you free. Quote, Sisyphus, knowing he is pushing his own rock, can contain his joy within. The universe is suddenly restored to its silence. The sound of outer space is deafening silence. Like that friend of Albert who decided to go back to the gulag, he could have found his own rock to push. If there is a personal fate to attain out there, there is no higher destiny. That management conquest mentality. Don't get conquested. My listeners out there, you guys are too philosophically enlightened. And then you can restore that Russian sternness of silence when you know you are following your own compass. He says each flake of the rock contains a microbial world. You can impose your destiny on a cell's fate. Like, again, get a pet. It'll make you feel better that you control when this thing gets to poop. Maybe there is a creator, but why does he, like, making people die of cholera eating their own poop while we bomb them? Again, don't be afraid to sail the Mediterranean. Some of the final quotes: the universe without a master seems neither sterile nor futile. Being agnostic, not saying there isn't a god, but saying I don't know what the dominating creator is out there. It's not a bad way to live. There's a whole lot of yin and yang. Things usually balance themselves out. Camus would have really liked the cliche, the journey is the destination, man. He said himself, the struggle itself toward the heights is enough to fill a man's heart. One must find Sisyphus happy. Ladies and gentlemen, that is the Myth of Sisyphus. What an absolute book. Slow it down, re-listen. It's a 100-page book. Easy enough read if you have done a couple poetry slam mics and you understand the language. It's beautifully written. Rehearse a couple lines to your girlfriend or a man on a ledge, and both of them will sleep with you. Thank you, Mr. Camus. I think what we have next from him is The Plague. It's a topical book, how he likes to talk about epidemics. So I'm going to use a heavy amount of satire when we go over that one. But we'll wait. Probably 2022, The Plague will go about. Again, can't recommend it enough. Cheers, Albert. Red wine and stinky cheese on the balcony tonight to celebrate your lifestyle. Men, go conquest, ejaculate on the canvas of life. Next week, we are starting off June, and it is an absolute controversial month coming up. We are going to start this one off with a tale of survival. Mr. Crack Hour is back for the hour with Into Thin Air. Usually we like to start off June with a bit of a psychedelic trip. I think these previous episodes were more than spiritual enough. We're about to fly to the Himalayas. Krakauer himself summited Mount Everest. And of course, he met with the people who had the worst story, a survival tale ever. If you've seen that movie, Everest, it's based off of this Krakauer book. And we didn't throw up big views on the last Krakauer tale, but these survival stories, they're fun, they're compelling, nail biters, edge of the seat. Can't wait to share that one with you guys. Let's beat the summer heat with some hypothermia. Thank you everybody for tuning in. Make sure you're on that Instagram, search up The Niche on YouTube. My memes will show up, funny one every night. Patreon at The Niche. Thanks again for listening. I'll see you guys next week. My name is Nick Muniz. Later.